are struggling in that online learning environment. So our original series is linked here if you're curious to look at any of those. Most of them would work for in-person strategies as well. You can check out our YouTube channel to watch some bite-sized chunks of these. And then we transition to hybrid strategies. So we have some more engagement strategies there for you as well. So please feel free to check those out. But today we're gonna get started warming up a little bit. Here's the strategies we're going to cover today. But on the next slide, we've got a song for you. And we're going to need, if you're able to turn your cameras on, that would be great. This will make this activity a little bit more fun. We're going to need your participation for a lot of things today. So when this song starts, you're going to have to get up and move. And I need you to find something green and something red. You have about 1 minute, we'll pause the song to get back in your seat. If you get back early, that's great. You can just dance and enjoy a little bit. If you're unable to have your cameras on, that is totally fine. You can use the chat and respond with green and red as well. But on your marks, get set, go.
What color is the sky? Ay, mi amor, ay, mi amor. You tell me that it's red. Ay, mi amor, ay, mi amor. Where should I put my shoes? Ay, mi amor, ay, mi amor. You say, put them on your hand. Ay, mi amor, ay, mi amor. You make me un poco loco, un poquitito loco. The way you keep me guessing, I'm nodding and I'm guessing. Now count it as a blessing that I'm only un poco loco.
All right, so we are going to use this to sign for agreement or disagreement, in this case, just an answer, just a visual cue. Whoops, I have both green up. Here we go, red and green. Would you rather sleep all day or be an early riser? Okay, we've got lots of early risers. Yeah, doesn't surprise me. Teachers in the room, one person to sleep all day. Good. Remember, you can also use the chat here if you'd like to respond that way as well. All right, next one. Would you rather fly like a bird or swim like a fish? Oh, a little bit more of a mix here. Nice. All right, let's try the next one. Would you rather go with no classroom AC or no classroom heat? Unfortunately, a decision some of us might have to make. I think no heat for me. Layers, layers. Awesome. Okay, I think we've got one more. All right, would you rather have recess duty or cafeteria duty? Oh, interesting. We've got a couple cafeteria duty people. Great. Okay, so this is something you could do with your students in class. Maybe let them know the day before they need to bring a red and green object. You can always use crayons or colored pencils. Just another way to get responses from everybody and engage them. But let's move on into what exactly engagement is, right? Engagement doesn't necessarily have to be eyes on the teacher, right? With everybody sitting still and quiet. We want our students to be engaged by showing that they are curious about learning, that they're optimistic, and they have interest in the content. So we love this definition here from the Glossary of Education Reform because it really speaks to us and what education means. And we hope, we strive to pull engagement from students with these different strategies. So we hope you like them as well. Our first strategy we have for you today is called linked connections. So a lot of what you're going to see today is ideas for building your classroom community at the beginning of the year, but that can also be used for content, right? We know that engagement has to come through building relationships with our students first. So this strategy comes from the game, you may have heard of it, The 6 Degrees of Kevin Bacon. It's the idea that you can choose any Hollywood actor or celebrity and somehow connect them back to Kevin Bacon through six connections. For example, George Clooney was in Ocean's 11 with Matt Damon, and Matt Damon was in The Departed with Jack Nicholson. Jack Nicholson was in A Few Good Men with Kevin Bacon. Okay, so finding those connections between people, their commonalities. You can do the same thing with your students at the beginning of the year, and then build on that as you get to know them. So for example, you might say something like, Andrea is connected with Ashley and Anna because both of their names start with A. And then Anna is connected with Rachel because they both love pizza. And Rachel is connected to Kathy and Maggie because they both have two siblings. So you can start small here with basic things that you can quickly learn about your students. Using letter names is great for our younger students. But then as you get to know them, you can find other commonalities and challenge them to make those connections. You might say, let's try to connect everyone in our class in only 10 links, right? So we've got to get everybody's names in 10 links. Or you might say, we're going to connect everybody using only food and try to figure out everybody's favorite foods and connect them that way. So a lot of different things you can do with this. Now, as we move into the content, you can keep this fresh by playing it in small groups, right? Letting kids in maybe groups of six find connections between each other. And then you can reuse the information. If you click, you can see, you might post this on a whiteboard and say, you know what? We played linked connections yesterday. Who remembers? Who are all the people who liked pizza in our class? And students can write down the names they remember and post it up on the whiteboard. Like I said, you can make themes for connections. You could use food, genres, academic content, who's everybody who loves math, things like that. And then one of my favorite ideas is to build in content with books, using this with literacy topics. So I chose a series of books here. Some of you may have read The Day the Crayons Quit. That character's name is Duncan, okay? And in the next book, we have another character named Duncan. So those books are linked because they share a character named Duncan. Duncan, the story dragon, is connected to We Don't Eat Our Classmates because they both have dinosaur characters. We Don't Eat Our Classmates is connected to First Day Jitters because they're both about the first day of school. So again, you can keep it very basic, surface level, things that students can see. But as they get better, or depending on the age level you work with, you could connect in genre, main idea, details from the story, and connect a whole string of books. You could do the same thing with numbers, posting a bunch of different numbers and having students find commonalities that way. All right, our next strategy, hot seat. This comes from a PD I attended a few years ago from our drama department here in APS. And the idea is to involve acting in academics. So again, using this at the beginning of the year to build relationships with your students, you can choose a volunteer to take the hot seat in the center of the classroom, maybe do fishbowl style, and the class gets to take turns asking questions. So these can be personal questions, trying to get to know students in your classroom. Again, at the beginning of the year, you may choose to do this in small groups instead so that students can really be engaged and everybody gets a chance to participate a little bit. Okay, so this is great for students because we know they need practice asking questions, it builds community, and it focuses on their oral language skills. So as we move into content, this can become a great idea if you want to use 20 questions. So you could use this with any content area, picking a concept or an idea. And now the hot seat student knows that secret concept, and everybody else has 20 questions to try to figure out what it is. Okay. Again, another ELA strategy, this is how I learned about this strategy, is to have your hot seat person be a character from a book. So then the students get to interview that character. They get to use a little bit of imagination and try to fill in those missing pieces from the story, or maybe dive deeper to ask further questions about the story. So if our hot seat character was the big bad wolf. I'm going to pick on Andrea here and ask her to be the big bad wolf. And I might say, big bad wolf, why did you try to blow the houses down?
They were in my way and I couldn't get around them, so I had to blow them down.
Okay, and how did you feel after you did that?
I felt very strong, but I also was a little bit sad.
Thanks. So you can see students can then act as the character. You can talk about point of view with this. And you can also get them to make some inferences about the story and pull those underlying meanings through hot seat. Okay, our next strategy. This is kind of a broad category. But last year, our students learned a ton of amazing technology tools because they had to, right? And most of these tools I put on here, CESA, Pear Deck, Nearpod, and Flipgrid, when these were originally designed, they were intended to be used in a physical classroom space. They are blended learning tools. So we now have the opportunity this year, your students have one-to-one devices, which has never happened in our district until last year, to use these tools for their intended purposes, which is meant to build engagement and participation from all students. So I encourage you, don't let these tools go under the rug and sweep them away because we're back in person. Use them and try to encourage your students to be use them for their intended purpose. So the one we're gonna try out today is Pear Deck, because this is something that we EdTech has paid for you for this year. So I'm going to take over the screen, Andrea, if that's okay. Because we are going to get on Pear Deck. So you can either, if you're on a phone or you have an iPad or wanna pull up another tab, you can go to joinpd.com and enter this code, but I'm also going to just drop a link for you if you prefer to click on that on your computer. Either one of those, and I'll give you just a second till I see we're all connected. So if you're choosing to go on your phone, it's joinpd.com, and then the code is JDJAKU. You see we've got one person connected already. Wait till we get a few more. Remember, alternatively, you can just click the link in the chat and that'll open up a new tab for you. I'm going to click continue. You can still absolutely join if you didn't get a chance to yet, but you should have an option to be able to draw or use a text box now and let us know, what is your favorite thing about summer? Did you enjoy about your summer? So again, at the bottom of my screen, I can see how many responses there are, and I'm going to wait until we have at least a couple more so I can show you what you can do with your students. But imagine projecting this on your Promethean board during a lesson and all of your students have their devices. They can all be responding. And I have a second screen up that I'm not sharing at the moment, which allows me to see what every student is doing with their name. So it's an accountability tool as well. But I'm going to go ahead and just show the responses at the moment. Notice in this view, there's no student names. This is anonymous. Okay, which can be comfortable for some of our students, especially if you're going to project all of their answers. So we can look at them individually, but we can also look in a grid layout. And again, we can look for some of those commonalities. If we think back to linked connections, we can start to look for links between these answers here. I see some people maybe went to the beach. We've got somebody gardening, sitting by the pool, hanging out with family. Right, so we can see everybody's responses all together. Now we're gonna try one more here. I want to know, where is your favorite place that you've traveled. So you should have a little icon that you can drag somewhere on the map. Let us know somewhere that you've traveled. So again, I can show the responses. And this one, you'll notice I'm over here in our overlaid layout. I can see all of your responses together. So this lets us see all of your pinpoints on the map. Again, we can look for commonalities and we can begin to ask questions, right? This might dive us into a deeper conversation. Now, I used this tool directly from Pear Deck. It's a template I did not create. I'm going to go ahead and hide our responses and head back over to our slide deck here. But I did not create this. Pear Deck has a lot of pre-created templates for you, and some of them have academic content included. So you can use this to build community at the beginning of the year for morning meetings, or you can use this for content for some of your lessons to get, like I said, engagement and participation from all students. Okay, our next strategy here is the unboxing video. This, again, comes from the idea of a YouTube trend. I don't know about you, but I get really excited when I get a new package on my doorstep, whether it's something I've ordered or something somebody sent me, but it is fun to open something new. YouTubers have taken a liking to that trend and they love to unbox things on camera. New products, things that are coming out, and they share about it. So I have an example of an unboxing video here if you need to check out what those look like of some new sneakers. But again, to get to know your students at the beginning of the year, imagine doing a version of show and tell with an unboxing video. Students can go home. Again, they have a device they can bring home with them. They can record themselves unboxing the things that represent themselves, the things that they would like to share with the class. And then you might have them present that video in class, maybe for part of your morning meeting. A couple students a day get to share a video. As I mentioned, one of our tech tools is Flipgrid. All students have access to that. You can have them record their unboxing video via Flipgrid and share it with the class. So that's how we can build community at the beginning of the year. But then, it's gonna play the video. Here we go. We can move that into content connections. So I got this idea from Ditch That Textbook. If you're curious, I have it linked in the notes of this slide deck. They have a whole bunch of ideas for you to use. But you can have students unbox what they know. So this can be a form of assessment at the end of a unit, or maybe a pre-assessment to figure out what your students already know. Maybe unboxing a time period, right? We learned about the 1800s last week. What are some things that represent that time period? Maybe a science concept or a character from a book. If we go back to the Big Bad Wolf, what kinds of things might we show somebody to represent the Big Bad Wolf? What would we put in a box? Maybe a genre or a geographical location. If we think back to that map we used, students might decide, I saw somebody it looked like was somewhere in Africa, South Africa perhaps. What kinds of things would we put in a box to represent that area? In fact, I did my own little unboxing here and I included a kimono and a cherry blossom and the Olympic symbol and one of my favorite foods from this location, ramen, to represent Tokyo because that's where the Olympics are happening. Right? So students could create a box like that, cutting out images or placing physical objects into a box. You might also put steps to a math problem, all cut up and kind of like a puzzle, and students pull it out of the box to try to rearrange it and figure out what the math problem is. All right. Okay, our next strategy is Guess Who, a classic game you may have heard of. This comes from, I believe, Ditch That Textbook. We got this template from. And this is something you can again use at the beginning of the year to build community and later on build in content. So it becomes a familiar structure for your students and it always stays exciting. So I have a template for you on the next slide that I'll show in a moment, but you're going to see that students will privately get one fact at a time. They'll slowly release. And students can then guess who that person is or what that concept is. So I'll show you the template here. And this is here for you to make a copy of if you'd like it. But the clues will slowly disappear until we get an image or a word, something to represent that. So let's give this a try. I am going to slowly release a clue. And you can use the chat box. As soon as you think you know who this person or thing is, let me know in the chat. So this person was born in Germany on March 14th, 1879. This person was a theoretical physicist. And our final clue is E equals MC squared. Yes, Albert Einstein. And then we can reveal that image, right? And students can maybe share a little bit more about what they know. Let's try another one. Okay, this is a polygon. So we've got a concept here now, a thing. This polygon has three sides. And this three-sided polygon has one angle that measures more than 90 degrees. Good, an obtuse triangle. I like how specific you are. Good. So we've got one more. Remember, as soon as you think you know what this is, go ahead and type it in the chat. This place has a population of 3.5 million. This place also has 3.44 head of cattle per capita. And our final clue is that it borders Argentina to its west and Brazil to its north. No guesses on this one yet. Chile's close. It's Uruguay. Good. Okay, so again, we might dive into some further discussion about that, connect it back to our unboxing strategy. Lots of things we can do with that. All right, our next strategy is virtual field trips. So we are allowed to go on field trips this year. Might not be possible depending on your situation, but virtual field trips can also pair really nicely with our physical field trips. This is going to capture your students' imaginations. It also gives us the opportunity to go places we can't go. We can go anywhere in the world with a virtual field trip. It works with all content areas. It builds vocabulary. You can use it as a hook and then dive deeper into something with your students. So get them excited about something and then start your unit. We have a bunch of sites linked here for you to try out our favorite virtual field trip sites. But we're gonna try this out today. We're gonna go on a geometry hunt in France. Oh, see if I hit my link right, here we go. So I'm gonna head over to AirPano. Okay, close out of these ads. There's some beautiful music. You can choose to use that or not. But with our young students, you may decide to look for shapes in France. Looking for 2D shapes, triangles, squares, circles, So you might send your students off with their devices and record all of the shapes that they can find in this area, right? So students can zoom around, they can click on different locations to see it up close. I apologize, I know it's going to take a moment to load, getting different angles of the city. And with our older students, you might advance this lesson and talk about 3D shapes or angles or distances, right? Anything to get them thinking about that concept, right? I noticed some rectangles on the street, lots of different things. And then this is something you could do on the playground as well, connecting those experiences, something virtual with something in person. All right, I'm gonna head back over here. And with that, I'm going to pass it off to Andrea to share our final strategies.
All right, welcome and good morning. The first strategy I'm going to share with you today is Foursquare. It's a pretty simple concept because it can be connected to any content area. The idea is start with a Foursquare, put in a subject matter, numbers, books, words, pictures, and think about ways that things are the same or different. This can be an intro into a lesson as well as an assessment if you needed to. Add some time to explain their thinking. Do this in groups and share ideas. Some of the favorite topics can easily be math numbers to start off a math talk for the day, story characters, vocabulary words, or even thinking about what's next. And so the first example that I have for you today is a Foursquare filled with four different numbers. Why do you think I put these four different numbers? Which one does not belong? Which one do we need to kick out? So if in the chat, Rachel, if you want to advance one more slide to our Foursquare, which of these numbers should we kick out? Go ahead and put that number in the chat. There are lots of possible answers. This gives a great opportunity for students to really explain their thinking and to connect with content. So I have 135. Sandra, if you also want to type in why you chose that number, Shirley as well. Why did you choose 135? There are so many different answers with this Foursquare. I see some that add up to be 9. I see some that are even or odd. I have 2 digits and 3-digit numbers, prime numbers. So many different ways to start this conversation. And a Foursquare is a perfect way to get students talking and really using that vocabulary to explain their thinking. And so while you don't know the topic that we were studying today, you can start to think about how Foursquare can really add in as a conversation starter as you introduce any new topic or content. The next Foursquare example that I'm going to share with you today is pictures. Now you can tell me which of these pictures does not belong. We have log and fish. We have frog and hog. That might have given it away by me telling you the names of the pictures, but let's see. Which one does not belong? Go ahead and type that in the chat and also give us your reasoning for which one does not belong. Carly says fish does not belong. Fish doesn't rhyme. Yeah, I'm pretty sure I gave that away by telling you the names of the pictures. Everyone picked my idea there. So thank you for playing along with those ideas. Before we go any further, Tracy, do you have a question? You raised your hand. Okay, we'll keep going. Think about different ways that you can add Foursquare into your day to really engage your students and get them talking about their ideas. The next strategy I'm going to share with you today is comics, and a really good way to engage reluctant writers. Comics are a fun way for students to really express themselves, either written or through illustrations. It also is a pre-writing strategy where you can map out what you're going to write about before you have to write about it. It also gives students an opportunity to write about a genre that they might be reading a lot about. And so giving them an opportunity to retell and focus on a specific skill, possibly inference, empathy, or even vocabulary words. We have some samples here for you, and they are linked here as well if you want to see them in action on a Jamboard, where these are finish the comic, as well as some empty comic frames for you. So you could see where some of the finish the comics could really lend students an opportunity to add in their own voice to their writing, as well as give them an opportunity to draw. Now you could also reverse this and they could only maybe write in the captions so that they're not necessarily drawing the pictures, but they're just finishing the story and adding in the sentences to tell what the story is all about. Jarrett Lerner is the author of these comics, and we have it linked here for you where he gives you tons and tons of templates that you can just go ahead and add into your day. These can be quick writes, these can be story frames, or these could be pre-writing activities. You can connect it to any content as well as an opportunity for students to start writing. So consider using comics as a way to engage writing and to help students with a fun genre of writing that's very similar to what they're reading, possibly. The next strategy that I'm going to give you, and I promise that there's only a few more, the next one is called Mystery Photo. Mystery Photo is just that, using a picture to start a conversation. The idea is that you take a displayed zoomed photo and you zoom it in. You've possibly seen these on TV shows. There's a game about zoomed in photos, and you can find these all over the internet. Take some time, think about what it could be, have students write descriptive words or start an idea about what they think it might be, share with either small groups or whole groups, incorporate in some talk moves so that students know how to respond to each other and are prepared with sentence stems. This could spark curiosity and really target vocabulary depending on the content that you're teaching. The idea is that a picture is worth 1,000 words. And this really does give an opportunity for students to start talking. So here's the one we're going to do today. I have a mystery photo here for you. We have a minute. I want you to take that think time and think about all the possibilities of what this photo could be and type that answer in the chat once the timer is done. So we have 1 minute. Think about what this could be and then type it in the chat. All right, so I see lots of sunflowers, flowers, and then I started to see people think that it was an eye. And those of you that chose it was an eye, you are correct. This is a zoomed in eyeball, but you can start the conversation of why did you think it was a flower? Have you ever looked up close to a flower or an eyeball? And really have that opportunity to engage in vocabulary. Now you could do this with just about anything to start a conversation. Think about science. Think about social studies or even language arts topics that a picture zoomed in like this might really give an opportunity for students to talk. We also have some ways to mix it up, reverse it, where the students have to maybe find a photo that represents a vocabulary word that they're working on, have it as a collaboration activity, incorporate talk moves, or even a mystery GIF. We do also have some prompts there from the New York Times that are linked for you, so you don't have to think of it, that it's already done there for you. So think about ways to incorporate mystery photo in to really grab some attention from your students. One of the last topics that I'm going to share with you today is called story cubes. These are possibly cubes that you have in your classroom or you've seen before. These are physical cubes that you can roll, have images on them, and are really fun. This is a great way to differentiate writing for your students and connect ideas and really to help them start strong because the ideas are already there for you. but I know that these cubes can be very expensive and I don't want you to spend money. So we found a digital version for you. It's linked there on the storyboard here. This allows you to choose between 1 and 50 dice. You can change and roll a new story if you want to, or you can even just pick an individual image and change it to match content that you're looking for. Once you have your story cubes ready, the idea is to start writing or even start having a conversation. This can be done individually, collaboratively, or even as a whole group morning start to start your day. So the idea is for a collaborative group to have students work in a group, choose the story cubes, invent the story, record themselves, possibly draw the illustrations, and work together. But today we're gonna do it all by ourselves. So today I've collected 10 story cubes for you. You get to choose which story cube you're gonna write about. You're only gonna choose one of them today, and you're going to give me 5 words to set the scene of your story. So one of the fun ones that I've seen recently was possibly number 3, which is a lion. And maybe we're starting the school year strong like a lion. And so I'm gonna write those 5 words to get started. Wait until the timer is done so that everybody's ideas populate at the same time and there's no distraction from our own thinking. So let's take 1 minute, choose a story cube, write your 5 words, wait to push enter until the time runs out.
The game begins in 3, 2, 1.
Right, let's see those stories.
The game begins.
5-word stories. Go ahead and enter them into the chat. Let's see what they were all about. Lots of possibility to be able to do some writing around story cubes today. Hopefully it's a great way to engage your students and get them to start writing. Maybe that's something fun that you can add in as an opener, and they have to use a story cube to tell about themselves. A fun way to reverse that is to also have them draw the story cubes that go along with a concept or topic that you're learning about and have them be the illustrator of the story cubes rather than using the story cubes to start them writing. So for your young learners, maybe they aren't writing yet, or as a fun way to mix it up, have the students draw the story cubes for you. It's a fun way to change that up as well. Strategy number 11 is, what do you meme? Maybe you've seen this game and it's another fun way to engage writing, build some community, have some fun, and start out with a team builder. These can also be quick. So I'm sure you've seen memes everywhere. Memes are just pictures or images with funny words or words on them that kind of describe how you're feeling, what you're thinking, that go along with the image. So today I have for you 5 images to consider. Image number 1, celebration. Image number 2, happy dog. Image number 3, I call him the ooh guy. Image number 4, creepy fox maybe. And image number 5, confused little girl. And so choose your image, write a meme with just a few words about how do you feel about going back to school. Which of these images reflect what you're thinking? And what are the words that you could put on this to reflect how do you feel about going back to school? Which one most matches you today in these early back to school days that we have? I'll give you a minute to go ahead and add that to the chat if you would. All right, I went ahead and created one for you. This is how I'm feeling about back to school. I also used number 5. When another teacher tells me they're so ready to go back to school, that's kind of how I feel. I needed a few more weeks, but I am happy to be back. So just a fun way. Students love memes. It's part of what they look at on their phones all day long. Why not incorporate it in as a way to get their attention, have them connect with content, and maybe use as a check-in every day to kind of see how they're feeling about the day. So have a great year using memes. The last strategy I have for you today is another one having to do with social media called Do You Even Emoji? Emojis are kind of everywhere. They're a fun way to get to know your students. This can be used as writing prompts, even a daily check-in for how they're feeling, a self-assessment, how they feel about a content or topic that you're learning about, possibly a way to get their attention. So emojis are a fun way to do that. Today, your assignment is to look at the emojis that I have for you and write one of their autobiography. What did this character do over the summer? Some of them are human, some of them are not human. So you have the opportunity to use something fun for an emoji and tell me a little bit of a story about what did one of these characters do over the summer. Because there are thousands of emojis everywhere, having your students have some choice and autonomy to choose the emoji or that best represents them or to write about emojis that are engaging and fun really does bring up that engagement factor and help for students to connect with each other. They can tell them they can tell their peers their stories. They could do this collaboratively, or they can save them and you can maybe tell emojis. Now we are done. We have shared with you 12 fast strategies to use in the classroom. We're sure that you also have strategies that are working in your classroom to build community. What do you plan to do in these first couple weeks of school to get to know your students, to help them get to know each other? We would love to hear from you what strategies work best. If you want to share one, maybe two strategies in the chat, even just the title of what do you usually do to build that classroom community. Knowing that we have many students coming back from what have been possibly 2 strange or interesting years of schooling, building that classroom community is more important than ever. What do you plan to do? What do you think works? All right, and to finish it up today, we are going to do a exit ticket. How many strategies did you learn today? If you learned only 1 or 2 ideas that you can possibly use, give me one of these dancing guys. We're going to dance it out today. Movement is important for engagement. If you learned 3 or 4 strategies, we're going to monster mash. We're going to monster mash it out. And if you learned more than 4 strategies that you could use possibly in your classroom, give us a dab. Let's see. We have cameras on. We have some dabs here. Perfect. Thank you all for engaging with us. Remember that this presentation will continue to grow. And if you have any ideas to add, please let us know. We would love to share some of your ideas. We are also here to help support anything that you possibly need in your classrooms. So feel free to reach out to us anytime. We can help with engagement, we can help with content, or even just some brainstorming ideas as you get back to school. Feel free to reach out to us. We're available to support at any time. Again, we want to thank you for being here. Rachel also dropped the sign-in form into the chat, so you want to make sure to sign in so that if anybody asks, we can tell them that you were here with us. And thanks for spending the first day back to school with us. We know that you have a lot of work to do and a lot on your mind, so thanks for spending a little bit of time with us. We do offer you 14 minutes of freedom, so we'll stay on to answer any questions, but if not, please make the most of your time and have a wonderful day, and thanks for being here with us.